I've tried all the pills, diets, and lemons, but the only way I choose to detox, the natural, easy way, is with the original Happy Feet Detox Patches. I can improve my health and well-being while I'm asleep. Try Happy Feet Detox Patches and be amazed.
Quiet, numbskulls, I'm broadcasting.
Ben Sorensen's Real Country Interviews, bringing you the stars of country.
James Blundell, g'day buddy, how you doing?
I'm doing well, Benny, yourself?
On fire today, as always. So you're touring, gigging and showing?
Yes, very much, actually. I'm just about to go back into the recording cycle, but I think I've been saying to your family correctly that really looking forward to this time because I'm just doing the wool shed at home and I've given myself anywhere from 4 to 8 months to record. So, you know, rather than just have to sit there still and try and get it all perfect in 4 weeks' time, I'm just going to take it steady.
And I think that you're at a stage where you're actually able to afford yourself that time and that space.
Yeah, exactly, mate. It's more important to make a great record than just make a record and get it out and tour it, you know?
Yeah, definitely, definitely. And, I mean, you've got so many great things in your world at the moment. You've got the farm, you've got a lovely wife and some great kids. So quality of life over that period of time is important as well, I'd think.
I think everything that you've just pointed out is what's going on. There's having relocated back to the property, you know, something I wish I'd done in hindsight, wish I'd done a decade ago, but circumstance didn't permit. Just the fact that I'm not, you know, hammering away at music 24/7 and sort of sitting around being bored waiting for the next thing to happen has been fantastic for the music. It's just sort of gone back to being fresh and exciting, and I'm really, I mean, I spent the last 48 hours working on a bulldozer, you know, it's just great diversity of day-to-day occupations, and everything's benefiting because of it.
Oh, it's a good way to be. Okay, you used to live in Sydney, and now you're out on the farm again in Queensland. So how important is where you live, and how has that changed your life and your family life?
Well, look, in the first place, the location issue has just evaporated. It used to be, I think, imperative to be in the capital city, close to air transport, you know, sort of finger on the pulse of the entertainment industry and such. It's changed so profoundly that where you live, as long as you've got pretty good computer access or internet access, it's not important to be in town. In actual fact, during the Telstra to Tamworth stuff, it's one of the things I was adamant about with the young artists, saying don't make the mistake of feeling you've got to rush to Sydney, Brisbane, Melbourne to further your career, because all you'll do is quadruple your living expenses and you won't be playing anymore, you know?
Mm.
In the first instance, I think that the pressure has gone off being in a very central location for your work. What are the benefits? What are the negatives of it? I think that because I've relocated, I'm now 28 miles from my nearest sizable regional centre, Stanthorpe, and 3.5 hours drive from Brisbane Airport. But it's no harder getting to Brisbane, get up at 4 in the morning, I'm down there to catch a 9 o'clock plane than it was trying to get across Sydney and take out traffic. So, you know, from my perspective, there are no negatives to decentralising and a huge amount of positive.
I think environmentally, there's also some really good advantages as a society as a whole to be decentralised.
Ben, I have been advocating for a long time, and particularly with the advent or the evolution of technology, I've been advocating people to get out of town. I think particularly with kids, when I have the boys with me, the difference I see in their day-to-day perception, their enthusiasm, and they're just the general bigger. They go to bed early, they sleep soundly and wake up ready to rip into the next day. They're always filthy by the end of the day, content and happy.
Now, that brings me to the next question. Every time I see you, you've got your kids and your wife with you. Now, every time. It's great.
Ben, you're a wonderful man. Jess is not my wife yet. We're working on that one.
Oh, sorry. It's just you guys get along so well.
Well, that's maybe because she's not my wife. You never know.
I know,
mate. We're very serious about trying to figure out when that all takes place. But I'll look up. I love the United States because one of the things that happened when Jess and I were first together, you know, that I'd spoken from the very first time we met a lot about the boys, and obviously in any fractured relationship you hope that both your children and your new partner have some degree of affection for each other, but the boys just adore Jess. They pay more attention to her than they do to me now. I actually love that. I think it's really good.
Oh, well, that's great, because every time I see you, you guys are just all one fantastic, cohesive group. And
well,
that's
really, really good to hear, man. Thank you.
And, that's why I just assumed.
Yeah.
So, given that, family must be pretty important to you.
Yeah, very much, Ben. And prior to this relationship, the relationship that the boys were a product of was foundering, I had the boys on one at a time on the road with me. I'd say 50% of the time. I remember taking both the boys out while I was still in nappies, and people would say, God, you're making a rock for your own back doing that. I said, well, it's either I will not see them, and I want them to understand what it is that I do, so they don't think I'm just disappearing because I couldn't be bothered staying at home, you know. As a result, that's been incredibly beneficial, much more so than I could ever have imagined or hoped, in that the boys have a real understanding of what the music industry is. They understand it's not all glamour, and they also understand that, you know, that it's not a simple matter of loving music and making a career out of it. In fact, both boys have a lot of music in them, but are very aware of alternative sort of career paths. So it's not they just want to be be a musician because their father was. They've seen the reality of it, and Jess is a great muso, and she said they've seen it at work in both the artist's life and in the relationship with the artist to another creative person. So they've had a real colouring on it, you know.
Mm, and I think it's great for them to, like you said, understand exactly what their old man does.
Yep.
And going on the road, it brings a lot of other benefits, I would think, to kids as well. Hopefully you've seen that as yourself. It's about meeting new people and making home wherever you hang your hat and wherever you are.
I think of all the things that come out of it, you've just articulated the greatest benefit is the ability to just be happy wherever you are. One of the things that I really like seeing about the boys is that they are they're comfortable with meeting new people. They are really adaptable. I mean, when they were at their early stage, they used to go to sleep in a pram under the sound desk, and the only time they ever woke up was when the noise stopped, you know. And I see again that when they're with their mates, their own age group, they're really good at being somebody that is aware of all the things that are happening in their group of friends. They're not, you know, they're not insular. They're pretty broad-minded little fellows.
And they're great kids too. I think I've got them nattering in the background with an interview I did with Wendy Matthews. And
that's a great person. That was good fun. Funnily enough, talking about kids, that's a girl that I'm really sorry never had children. I think she'd be a great mother.
Oh, she'd be absolutely brilliant. She's so incredibly down to earth,
isn't she?
And just the most openly loving individual.
Yeah.
It's just great. So, you know, I think that through her music, she's been mother to a lot more people.
That's very true. Yeah, very true.
Now, we've talked about your kids. Now, what were you like as a little fella? What was home life like for you?
Really, really blessed. You know, grew up on, we had at that stage of the game, 12,800 acres of mixed grazing and cropping, merinos, herefords and dry land farming for oats and barley.
Yep.
I can't remember. Jess and I were just having a discussion the other day. She said, can you remember the first time you sat on a horse? And look, loosely, I think I was about three. You know, before that, I'd have been chucked up in front of the saddle with the old man at the end of a day's work and mustering, sort of going out on a pony and trying to keep up with the big boys. I was about 6 to 7, which is always hard work. An amazing amount of personal freedom. If there was a negative from the childhood I had, is that I found it really quite hard to conform to society and restrictions in a metropolitan sense. I don't quite get why people do that to themselves. I did it for 22 years in Sydney. So.
Yeah, well, I actually find that, now that you've mentioned it, that theme, I think, almost came through some of your early musical work. And I think that's one of the reasons why Australia fell in love with it.
Look, Ben, I appreciate that. There was a period of time that I was writing that stuff and trying really, really hard to. Ironically, it is in parallel with the statement we're talking about, or the issue we're talking about before getting people to centralise. I was trying desperately hard back then to point out to people that life in regional Australia, far from being an inferior or a substandard existence, was just so bloody wonderful that yeah, it was a huge drive in the music all the way through. And the other thing, I don't know whether you'd have been aware at the time, but there was a very big public slant towards country music as being this kind of cheap and cheerful and, you know, slightly bloody to be pitied music form. That used to get right under my skin because I met some of the most intelligent people I know in the world having the sticks and was always sort of trying to champion that viewpoint.
I'd almost call you the Moody Blues of country.
Thank you, mate. That's great.
You can be just as night in white satin.
Yeah, great.
Good stuff.
You, mate.
Thanks, buddy. See ya.
Cheers, man. Bye.
Well, he weren't much tall, just broad and powerful. His hardened hand had never felt a glove. He could swing an axe all day and not raise a blister. He could sew up a cut with a touch of love. He taught me, peel that bike back, slice through the sapwood, keep on chipping till the blade bite's good. If you want to make what you build last longer, you gotta keep chopping till you hit good wood. Of all the skill the old man mastered, I guess his best was axe and abs. He could take a tree and make a monument to the bushman's cry, a building fences and yards. I helped him peel that bark back, slice through the sapwood, keep on chipping till the blade bites good. If you want to make what you build last longer, you gotta keep chopping till you hit good wood. Straight and true, we've weathered well
to peel that bike back, slice through the sapwood, keep on chipping till the blade bites good. If you want to make what you build last longer, you gotta keep chopping till you hit good wood. Hit. Till you hit good wood. Wanna build something that's gonna last a lifetime? You gotta hit good wood.
Another Ben Sorensen Real Country interview. Hear this interview and many more at www.realcountrymix.com.